Good morning, sir. My name is Arjun, and I am from a evidence law project. I have taken Govinda Swamy versus State of Kerala for my case comment. This judgment is also properly referred as Swamy rape case, but a few articles said that even referring to a rape case by the name of victim is a type of violence. They made sense, so I will be referring to this case as Govinda Swamy rape case. So this case has been one of the most controversial judgment which was given by Justice Ranjan Gogoi. There were several debates whether on the legal validness of this judgment, and I am of the view that this judgment was problematic and the court erred in its decision making. Before beginning, I would like to say that the articles that were in support of the judgments, I found out that they were written after solely reading the Supreme Court judgment, which was a 9-page judgment. In order to get a true understanding of what the actual scenario was and why is this correct or incorrect, a reading of the High Court judgment along with the Supreme Court judgment is a must. The High Court judgment is a 115-page judgment, and it has dealt with each and every aspect of this case in great details and have recorded all the findings of the trial court. Now, firstly, the facts of the case are, the Swamy, the victim, was a 23-year-old woman who was traveling by train to her home village for her own marriage ceremony. When the train reached second last station before her destination Shonar, she was the only person left in the ladies' compartment. The accused, Govinda Swamy, who was an habitual offender, saw this and take benefit of the opportunity, entered the compartment with the aim of sexually assaulting. Swamy, on sensing this, tried to escape, but he held her head by snatching her hair, pulling her hair, and then repeatedly, violently banged her head against the train wall. He banged her head 5 to 6 times and then purportedly threw her body out of the train. Swamy fell on the railway crossing on her face, and there were severe injuries caused on her left side of the face. He, Govinda Swamy, then himself jumped off the train and dragged her towards the bushes. At this time, the train was moving at a slow speed. It was just leaving the junction. And this whole incident was witnessed by two witnesses, prosecution witness one, prosecution witness two. They wanted to intervene, but they did not, because they were stopped by a middle-aged man who said that the victim has escaped, and therefore there is no need to drag them all in this case, in police matter. The two people, after the train reached Shonur, went to the railway guard and informed them about the incident. After an investigation, thorough investigation, the Swamy body was found lying beside the railway track in a critical condition. She was admitted to the hospital, and 5 days later, she succumbed to her injuries. The post-mortem report of Swamy indicated that she had suffered 24 serious anti-mortem injuries, and her death was a result of the combination of injury number one, which was caused by banging her head against the train wall, injury number two, which was the fall on the railway crossing, and the other injuries resulted from sexual assault. The trial court convicted the accused for and sentenced him for the offense of robbery, rape, and murder. The High Court upheld the same. However, the Supreme Court overturned the conviction under murder. It upheld the conviction under rape and robbery, but it overturned the conviction under murder, stating that there was no clear intention of the accused to murder the victim. And secondly, there is a bit ambiguity, and the court is not completely convinced that his act are the one that resulted in Swamy's death. Each aspect of this judgment can be a separate research topic in itself, which I did not realize before beginning the project. And therefore, in my paper, I have broadly highlighted three main aspects that are concerned with the subject matter and have briefly discussed them, meeting the word limit. So firstly, my argument is that the Supreme Court's interpretation of Section 300 to determine that there was no sufficient intention to make him liable for murder is problematic. Secondly, my argument is that the Supreme Court's reliance on hearsay evidence and superseding the contradicting evidence in the form of extrajudicial confession and medical reports submitted by the prosecution is itself problematic. And lastly, even if we believe that Swamy had jumped out of the train, which is the court's doubt on the injury number two, even if we believe that she had jumped out of the train, it would not have absolved the accused of his liability. Now, moving towards the first part, the court said that there was no intention of the accused to murder the victim. They said that there was sufficient intention to rape her, but there was no intention to murder her. And this can be understood from the fact that the victim was left in a supine position. The banging of her head was done with the intention of not killing her, but making her unconscious. And lastly, the victim survived 5 days. So these three facts show that The intention of the accused was merely to rape her, but not to murder. However, this interpretation of the court is problematic because the third clause of third part of the section 300 clearly says that if the intention of the accused is to cause such injuries which are in ordinary course of nature sufficient to cause the death of the person, then the person should be held liable for murder. The High Court and the trial court both relied on the third part of the section, while the Supreme Court relied on the first part, and both these court convicted the accused. The High Court even specified two most relevant cases. One was Birsa Singh versus State of Punjab and Jagroop Singh versus State of Haryana, which were considered as landmark cases for convicting a person under the third clause of Section 300. And all in all, these two cases briefly summarize the point that if the intention is clear of causing such injuries which are sufficient in ordinary course of nature for causing that, the person should be held liable for murder. Further adding what the prosecution submitted, the prosecution witness number 64, Dr. Shirley Vatsu, who at the time conducted post-mortem report and the head of the team, five-member doctor team, who was overseeing this case, clearly set out and which is also noted by the paragraph number 155 of the High Court judgment, that injury number one was itself sufficient in ordinary course of nature to cause the death of the victim. Therefore, injury number one and the sexual assault, they both are sufficient to cause the death of the victim in an ordinary course of nature. And this aspect was clearly ignored by the Supreme Court. The other problematic part that the Supreme Court said that the victim survived for 5 days after the incident shows that there was no intention of murder. One of the doctors who conducted the examination clearly said that she was under stage 4 coma and her life vitals were in critical condition, and had there been no ventilator and other services, the victim would have died then and there. Therefore, the court's argument that the victim survived for 5 days and not linking with the intention is itself problematic. Moving towards the next part of the project, which is the court's reliance on hearsay evidence, is contradicting is because the Supreme Court relied on the testimonies that were provided by prosecution witness number 4 and 40. They said that the middle-aged man who was unknown, and the High Court said that there have been thorough investigation to find this middle-aged man, but have been failed. So this middle-aged man claimed that he had seen someone escaping from the train, and therefore the court formed the opinion that the victim had escaped first. And this is hearsay evidence because both the prosecution witness number 4 and 40 had themselves not seen this. Section 60 of the Evidence Act restricts hearsay evidence to be admitted except in certain exceptions, which are certainly not applicable in the current case. This High Court also noted this view that since the testimony given by the old man was not cross-examined, therefore it should be considered as unworthy and inaccurate and should not be held admissible. However, the Supreme Court relied on this and superseded this hearsay evidence over the medical evidences submitted by the prosecution and the extrajudicial confession made. The prosecution witness number 64, which was head of the post-mortem team, she clearly said that the injury number one, which was suffered by the victim, was sufficient to make the victim go in a dazed state or unconscious state. Therefore, the victim in no way could have escaped from the accused. Further, this is further emboldened by the part that the victim had suffered injuries on her face, the injury number two, which was caused on face. The injuries were caused on the vital parts of the face, and these two photos, that though not accurate, but I'm to try to convey the point that when the accused victim fell from the train on the railway tracks, had her reflexes action were working, had she been conscious, then her hands or her arms would have acted as a cushion to save her face. However, no such injury was present on her hands or arms, and there were severe injuries on her face. So this clearly shows that the victim was not in a conscious state, and hence clearly implies that the accused had pushed her out of the train. The Supreme Court said that they believe the accuracy of this. However, they are still not convinced that the victim had not escaped, but they did not provide any such reason why they have this doubt. Secondly, which is more problematic thing, that the accused himself had extrajudicially confessed that he pushed her out of the train. The prosecution witness number 47, who was conducting medical medical examination of the accused, the accused voluntarily, without any coercion or presence of any police officer, told him about the whole scenario which happened, and also clearly specified him that he had threw her out of the train to drag her outside and cause a sexual assault. the Supreme Court, as the High Court and the trial court, both relied on this extrajudicial confession. The High Court, from paragraph number 254 of the judgment, dealt with this extrajudicial confession in detail and mentioned several judgments which embodies that there is this extrajudicial confession which was made to the doctor in the absence of any police or constable, should be held admissible and should be considered as evidentiary, and should be considered as important evidence. And based on this extrajudicial confession, they convicted him under murder. However, the Supreme Court did not consider this extrajudicial confession in the review petition or in the appeal and judgment. And it briefly touched upon the part that there was an extrajudicial confession made, but since the prosecution has not raised this matter, therefore they should not deal with this. Lastly, the part that I'm arguing is, even if we assume that Somaiah had jumped out of the train, it should not have absolved the accused from his liability. The court said that the jumping out of the train was considered as an act of intervention, therefore breaking the causation chain. However, the several international judgments, such as R versus Elium or R Royals versus R, in those cases, the court said that if the victim's act was in response to the accused violence or injury, and in order to save himself or herself, the victim has suffered certain injuries, then those injuries should be considered as a direct consequence of the act of the accused, and the accused should be held liable for the same. In the two judgments which were cited by Attorney General in the review petition, which was Basappa versus State and Joginder versus State of Punjab, to argue that the Govind Swami liability was still present irrespective of Swami jump or not, was also considered by the court. In Basappa versus State, what happened was, the person was on this roof and 4 to 5 defendants or accused tried to murder him. So to save himself, he jumped from the roof and sustained severe injuries. The accused then picked him up from the floor and burned his body. The post-mortem report was not clear on the part if the death had occurred due to the falling from the roof or by the burn injuries. But the court said, irrespective of the fact the person died by burning or died by falling from the roof, both should be considered as a consequence of the accused act, and therefore they should be held liable for the murder. In the Joginder Singh versus State of Punjab, what happened was, the person was sitting in his room. The two accused approached him with the intention of killing him, and to save himself, he jumped in the well. While jumping in the well, his head struck the well wall and he drowned then and there. The court in this case, though absolved the victim for the murder and convicted them under homicide, the court said, had there been no such option for escape for the victim, then in such scenario, his jumping in the well and then dying by the same should have been considered sufficient for convicting the accused for murder. To summarize what the international judgments and the national judgment, the position is, in case of victims in the causation, if the act of the victim was a direct response to the act of the accused and the victim's act was reasonably foreseeable, then the accused should be held liable for all the consequences that follow upon. In the present case, firstly, the escape, if we are assuming that Somaiah had escaped, then the escape is directly a consequence or a response to the accused act of sexually assaulting him. Secondly, the fact that should be considered was that the train was moving at a slow speed. There were co-passengers in the other compartment, but none of them intervened. So the only possible option for a person to save herself was running out of the train. Therefore, the action of running out was clearly foreseeable, and hence the accused should not have been absolved from his liability of causing the murder of the victim. Therefore, the Supreme Court, however, did not consider these facts, and it simply rejected these arguments. It did not give any such reason in the review petition. So to conclude my argument for the project is, firstly, that the Supreme Court's reliance on the hearsay evidence and superseding the medical report submitted by the prosecution witness, along with the extrajudicial confession, which has been by the statute and as well as by the judicial precedents given a greater value, is really problematic. Secondly, the court's interpretation of Section 300 and determining that there is no sufficient intention to cause murder. And lastly, is for the court to avoid this chain of causation of foreseeability test to determine the liability of the accused had the victim and escape is highly controversial. And I would further say that this was one of the great opportunity for the court to develop this doctrine of causation to be applied in the case, but it did not do so. Hence, the judgment is certainly problematic, and it provides more leeway for the accused, even in the most evident cases, to save themselves from the charges of murder. Thank you, sir.